If you have a mobile studio, you have access to what I think is the simplest, least expensive optical communications demo or experiment that exists anywhere. So if you have the mobile studio, as is shown here on the left, you need a very small number of components, and you can build something that is really, really simple and clearly demonstrates that you can send information on an optical signal, in this case an audio signal. Before going into how it's actually done, let me show you how it looks when it's being operated. And another feature of the mobile studio is, because it's run from a laptop, you can run it remotely from anywhere. And what I did here was to run this experiment from Wisconsin when the setup was on my desk at home in New York. In order to do this, I used TeamViewer. There's lots of other programs that you can use for this. One nice thing about TeamViewer is that it is free for academic uses, and it does work really nicely. Okay, so what's shown here is the desktop for the mobile studio. The blue curve on the blue signal on the top is the original signal, and the green signal on the bottom is the signal detected by the optical communication system. The setup is shown in the upper right hand corner, and you can see the mobile studio board in the video window here. This is one of the nice features again of TeamViewer, is that you can set up a camera and communicate with someone at the other end, or you could look at what you're actually doing. In this case, I have the mobile studio board in the lower right hand corner of this window. It's being held up by the posable Einstein doll that one of my daughters gave me for a Christmas present, partially just for fun and partially as a scale to scale the picture a little bit, but you can see the light bulbs sitting on my desk. In the picture, you can also see a small protoboard sitting on its edge with a blue LED that's flashing enough to be able to see the blue light. And next to it is the solar cell that's detecting the signal. Okay, so from this picture, there's no sound in this case, but from this picture you can see that the input and output signals look very close. There's a little bit of additional noise on the output signal. That's primarily the 120 hertz modulated light coming from almost any light bulb, and in this case it was an LED bulb that was illuminating my desktop. In this case, it's the top of my actual desk, not the mobile studio desktop. So that's what we are going to see how to do, and I'll go back to the beginning of this write-up and show you how that works. Okay, so here's the mobile studio, the red tube board, and we're going to only use the oscilloscope capabilities and the function generator capabilities in order to make this work. So what are the parts that we need? So of course it's the standard mobile studio I/O board, the desktop software, and a laptop computer. Next, you need a solar cell. We're using the solar cell as an optical detector in this case. You can get them in lots of different places. The very first time I did this experiment, I used a solar cell that I built as an undergraduate many, many years ago. But the one that I recommend, because it works very well, is this $10 solar cell from Edmund Scientific. It's a 3-volt, 20 milliamp solar cell, and does a nice job of responding to the optical signal produced by the LED. Okay, for the optical signal, we are going to produce that with a blue or a white LED. Actually, you can use lots of different ones, but this seems to work quite well. Remember that the basic difference between a blue LED and a white LED is that a white LED is a blue LED with yellow phosphor, and the yellow phosphor is used to spread out the spectrum to produce light that looks quite white, producing a spectrum close to ordinary sunlight. It actually works very well. It of course has a fairly high peak in the blue because of the source of the light, but the white light produced by white LEDs is pretty natural looking. In order to use an LED, you need to have a current limiting resistor, and that's in this case, it could actually be a bit smaller than what I'm specifying here, but this is good for reliability and for keeping your LED from maybe overheating if you try to drive it a little bit too hard. So a resistor about 500 ohms is fine. The two closest standard values are 470 and 510. Either one is fine. Even if you can't get all that close to this, anything in that ballpark is really fine. You need some wires to hook it up. It doesn't say a protoboard because that's not essential, but a protoboard is nice in order to set the thing up quickly. Part of the demonstration slash experiment is to be able to hear the sound that you are sending over the light using the light pulses from the LED. And so you need a set of earbuds or headphones. It's also possible to use powered speakers, which I recommend. It adds another dimension to it and also allows you to share the experiment with other people rather than just passing headphones and earbuds around. Okay, what's next? Next, you need a sound file. For the mobile studio to use a sound file, the most convenient form is a WAV format, which is indicated here in the first sentence under item number one. You can select any audio file you want. In fact, you can make your own audio file if you want to, as long as it's in WAV format. Not all files work. I've tested a whole bunch of them. I think I tested probably 60 different files. And the ones that do work for this purpose, I put a few examples in this location right here. So if you go to that location, you will find some with offset, some without offset, and I recommend using the ones without an offset because they're really easier to work with. Okay, so once you've got a WAV file, the next thing is to set up the hardware. Now, a solar cell comes with two wires, a red wire and a black wire. Connect the red wire to A1 plus and the black wire to ground. On the mobile studio board, connect the LED resistor combination to the arbitrary waveform generator and ground. For clarity, I just brought back the pinouts for the mobile studio, and you notice that A1 plus and ground are in the lower right-hand corner, and the AWG1 and ground are a few pins up from there. So you're really only making four connections to the mobile studio board, one set to drive the LED and one set to detect the light using the solar cell. Okay, now we're back with the instructions. You want to be sure that when you set it up, if you remember the picture I showed you before, you want to set it up so the light from the LED shines on the solar cell. This should be obvious, but it's a good idea to point it out because sometimes people just set things up and don't think things through. If you think about the big picture, obviously the sound is being carried on the light, so the light has to illuminate the detector. At this point, you should turn on the mobile studio and select the arbitrary waveform generator. And up will come a display that looks like this. Once you have a signal of some kind being produced by the arbitrary waveform generator, it will show up in the upper display, which is like an oscilloscope. And the lower display, it will actually show the frequency spectrum. Okay, it's hard to read what's going on here, so I have blown up the window on the lower left-hand corner where we upload the signals. So this is what it looks like. So this is the waveform components window. And what you want to be able to do is select where it says audio. And then on the right-hand side of the upper right-hand side is this little button with some dots on it. You click on that and then you can search for where you put the WAV files that you either downloaded from where I've put them or you downloaded from other source on the web. Or maybe you made one at home on your laptop. Okay, so once you've identified a particular file and you'll see here that the name of the file is listed there as to import. Okay, we want to add that to the left channel. There's a button here in the lower right hand corner that says add to left channel. So you have the file, you have to put it into memory for the left channel. But before you do that, you have to be sure that you're actually sampling the signal correctly. If you try to sample at too high a rate and get too fine a detail in the signal, you may not get your entire signal because there's a limit to how much the buffer can hold. So this is what I recommend you set up. You set up the sampling rate at about 11 kilosamples per second, and make sure it's that you've selected loop continuously, because you want this to keep playing over and over once you get to running the experiment, so that you can hear it over and over and try different things with the setup. Okay, the 11 kilosamples per second does a good job of reproducing moderately poor audio, so it's fine. And you will generally be able to, you'll be able to hear any of the signals that I've downloaded and probably anything else that you want to work with. Okay, now that you've got that, then you click the Add to Left Channel button. And what that'll do is it'll show you what the signal looks like on the oscilloscope, which is now in the upper display. Okay, so there, it's a series of words, and so you will see a burst for each of the words that are spoken. And then in the lower display, you'll see the spectrum of signals produced throughout the frequencies produced throughout the signal shown above. I can't see it very well here, but on the in the window in the lower right under Waveform Builder, you will now see that that signal has been loaded into the arbitrary waveform generator buffer, and eventually you'll be able to send it to the hardware and be able to, you'll be able to look at it. Okay, there is no offset, so we have to add an offset in this case. And so on the lower left hand corner again, where you found audio, you need to click on DC. You need to click on DC and add select 3 volts as the offset. And then once that's selected, then again you hit the add button here, and then the 3 volts will show up on the lower right hand side. So now this is all loaded together. You've made a signal out of this, and you need to now send it to the hardware. So this is the waveform builder. You have the signal all set up, and now you want to send it to the hardware itself so that it can play it back over and over. All right, you want to close the arbitrary waveform generator because it's just taking up space, and it will keep sending the signal out forever anyway, so you don't need to be able to see that anymore. Open the oscilloscope. It says here to how to set up the channel 1 volts per division to 500 millivolts, coupling the DC input to A1SE, which is where we wired it up. Set the horizontal time scale to 20 milliseconds per division and turn off the trigger. You don't want to use normal triggering in this case because it's not really a repetitive signal. If your LED is shining on the solar cell, you should see a signal on the top that changes with time as the sound file is played back over and over. This step is essential because you may there's a little bug in the software, so that if you don't set it up to run the oscilloscope properly, it doesn't actually set the gain properly in the audio. Okay, now you want to be able to hear it, and in order to be able to hear it, you select audio, make sure you clicked enabled. The left source and right source to be A1 and A2. You can actually have these come directly from the arbitrary waveform generators, but you want to be able to hear what is coming from the solar cell. Set the volume at a comfortable level, and you should now be able to hear the signal. And that's it. So you set up the arbitrary waveform generator, you send the signal to the hardware, you look at it on the oscilloscope, make sure it's producing the signal that you want, set up audio so you can hear it, and you should be able to hear the signal coming through the earbuds. All right, that's it. For completeness, just to show that one of the aspects of what's going on here, the reason we can use the solar cell for this purpose is that it does respond in the audio range. And so I just sent some standard signals through the system In this case, I used a blue LED. I did it at 1 kilohertz and 5 kilohertz, and I looked at the input and output. So at 1 kilohertz, the blue signal in the upper left-hand display here is the input, and the green signal is the output. And you notice that the input and output are both pretty clean sine waves. Let's move down to here. On the left-hand side, we have a triangular wave going in. And it should be a triangular wave being detected, but because the triangular wave requires some higher frequency components in order to be reproduced, it doesn't actually go through the system all that well. And so it's sort of triangular, but not really. Much more dramatic is the square wave. So here, in the right side here, you see the square wave input in blue, and the green signal is what's being detected by the solar cell. You can see the solar cell is unable to respond instantaneously to the square wave, and so we end up with something that shows an exponential rise and fall, and the demonstrates that the frequency response of the solar cell is not really all that great, but it goes well into the audio range, and so this demonstration really works remarkably well for something that was never intended to be an audio detector. At 5 kilohertz, it becomes more dramatic. You can't see the scales here, but the signal level at 5 kilohertz on the output is smaller than it was at the at 1 kilohertz. And that's because the frequency response is beginning to fall off at that point. On the bottom, again, you can see it's pretty dramatic. The triangular wave going in, shown on the right, produces something that's almost exactly a sine wave. It only picks up the fundamental, but it's not getting any of the higher frequencies. And the square wave, all you see is the beginning of the charge and discharge cycle that's shown more completely up here at 1 kilohertz. At 1 kilohertz, it looks like it's almost up to hitting the asymptotic level it should have at long time. So you can see in a millisecond, it should be able to pretty much respond and charge and discharge. But at 1/5 of that time, it only goes partially up that exponential curve. It's only this lower left-hand part here and the lower upper left-hand part over here. So that's it. It shows that the system works. And again, this shows the demonstration again that I did remotely. The two things about this that are probably the most dramatic. One is that you can see from this that the input and output signals really do look very much the same. And then I recommend you try it and see what it sounds like. It does indeed produce a very intelligible signal. And if you stick your hand in front of the LED, the sound goes away. If you aim the LED away from the detector, the sound goes away. It's all the basic features of an optical communication system. And it's very simple to set up, very reproducible, and has pretty much all of the lessons you need in it to understand how an optical communication system can work. And that's it. I recommend trying it, as I said. If you have any questions, always feel free to contact me.